Hello and welcome back. Now, quite a long time ago, I got a request from a viewer called Mesut Erden about simulating filters for switch mode power supplies. And today, it's finally time to look over that. So if you're curious about the best ways to simulate a switching supply for the purpose of noise simulation in LTSpice, what are the easiest ways to simulate all the noise sources that you can get in a power supply, and then of course some possible filtration methods, then keep watching. So normally, if you want to simulate a power supply, it's probably going to look like this. So this is a text fixture from one of the components in the LTSpice library, and you got your basic IC, your switching transistor, the power stage, feedback network, compensation pins, frequency setting, quite a complicated circuit. And because of this, it will also work a bit slower than you would normally want it to, since the program needs to simulate all these extra components that have the role of fine-tuning the operation of the supply. They don't really have any purpose in generating extra noise though. Now, there's a better way of doing this, because if you want to simulate only the noise that the supply generates, then you will probably not be interested in the exact frequency setting resistor or the exact feedback network. My point is, you only need to simulate the components that you actually need. So your basic power stage related components, the switch, the diode, the inductor, input and output capacitor, and the load. And a driving signal, you can use a basic pulse source, with some parameters based on your power supply driver. So these parameters can be based on whatever IC you want to use in your actual supply. This of course being the case of the buck supply. Now if it's a boost or anything else, then of course you will need to rearrange this. So by doing this, your simulation will run much faster than if it would be trying to take care of all the other things like compensation and so on. Since the point is not really to see how accurate your output voltage is to see how the supply is switching, since that's the main noise generator. Now the next thing to work on is improving simulation time. You can see that in my first circuit, it takes quite a while for the output to reach a steady state behavior. So we got all this oscillation going on in the startup phase. Now, what I recommend to do to get this time as short as possible is to help your supply out a bit by adding this extra supply which will charge up your output to a voltage close to your output voltage, and from that voltage onwards to let the supply work on its own. So if I look at the output of the second circuit, we can see that from the very beginning, it was already close to my output voltage of around 5 volts. And then with a very short oscillation, it got there. So by doing something like this, you can improve your supply turn-on speed. Now, once you manage to simulate your circuit, and in a fast way, there will be something that you might notice. And that being that all of the waveforms related to your power supply are all textbook straight. So if we look in a theoretical document about power supplies, like this very good document, I highly recommend this, you will see that for the buck converter, all your waveforms are nice and straight, very sharp edges, nothing very interesting going on. Just like we got in our simulation, everything is perfectly straight, no drama, nothing very interesting. Now, on the other hand, if you have worked in the past with power supplies and you actually took an oscilloscope to look at any of these waveforms, you will know that they don't look like this at all. I mean, they broadly look like this, but there's all sorts of oscillations here and there at each of these edges. So the next thing you will need to do to simulate the actual noise is to replace your ideal components with some real components. I replaced my ideal diode with a real diode. I switched my ideal switch with a PMOS transistor, and this time if I look at the exact same waveforms, so the current through my inductor, it's roughly the same, but the voltage in my switch node starts to get a bit off. So you got a certain fall time, a certain rise time, a bit of delays here and there, so we're starting to get to something that resembles some real life behaviors. Now, when I mean replace the ideal components with real components, I don't just mean the switching components, I also mean the passive components. And by that, we need to add all the parasitics to our passive components. For example, an inductor has a certain series resistance, this is always written in the datasheet, and it also has some parallel capacitance. And you can work this out from the resonant frequency of the inductor. In the same way, capacitors also have series resistance and series inductance, depending on what type of capacitor you're using. And if you take also these things into account, then your waveforms will start to get a bit more affected. So not by a lot, but we're getting there. We can see that we already have this little bump here in our inductor current, which is not supposed to be there, but this is good. We're starting to simulate closer and closer to a real circuit. So what else is missing? Now there's one more parasitic to add. Those are parasitics caused by the layout of your circuit, since you will not be able to make a perfect layout with no parasitics. All your traces will have inductances, capacitance, and resistance. And what I got here is just a 1 nanohenry inductor in series with my diode, another 1 nanohenry in series with my transistor, and 1 picofarad from the switching node to the ground. So let's see if this has any effect on our circuit. You might already notice that the simulation is running much, much slower. And if we look in the switching node, we start to see this noise going on. So we got this ringing in our switching node. Something perfectly normal happens in every supply. And based on how well you will model these parasitics, you will get more or less of this noise. Now the purpose, of course, being to have a simulation that is as accurate as possible to real life. So ideally, what you will want is to measure your real circuit and then try to make a simulation that gets as close as possible to that. So moving on, now that we got our circuit with all the noise in it, let's see how we can get rid of it. So let's start simple. Let's start with the output noise. Now in this simulation, I got a bit more inductance in my traces, and we can see that on our output, there's quite a lot of noise, and especially high frequency noise. So all this is running at around 100 megahertz. Now the easiest way to handle this noise is to add an inductor and capacitor filter. And by doing this, you will see that all the high frequency noise basically disappears. So if possible, then a low value inductor will have very high benefit, especially for high frequency noises. But if not, then you will just need to work on your output capacitor. Maybe add something with lower inductance or something with lower equivalent series resistance. Now, of course, this is about solving the symptoms. It's not actually about solving the root cause. So we got all this noise, but we're just putting a band-aid on it using such a filter on the output. The next best thing that we can do is try to reduce this noise. And since we remember that all this noise came about the moment we added these inductors in our switching node, so all the noise is based in our switching node, we can start to try to filter this. And the most common and most easy way of filtering out most of this high frequency noise is to add a snubber. Basically, it's a series resistor capacitor circuit over the switching elements, either the diode or the transistor. You can try out both ways, you will get different results. Now by adding this, you can see that simulation time has greatly improved because most of the noise has improved. So by adding this sort of snubber, you can get away with filtering most of your very high frequency noise. The only downside being that you will have a certain amount of power dissipated on your resistor. So this is quite a good and easy way of filtering out most of your noise from where it's actually being generated. Other things could include filtering your transistor command, so trying to slow down your transistor to have slower rise and fall times. So okay, that about covers output noise and the main noise sources inside the power supply. There's one more very important noise which at the moment we can't really simulate, and that is input noise. If we look at it, no matter what kind of capacitor I put here, how good or bad it is, there's absolutely no noise. The input voltage is dead straight. That is because I'm using an ideal input supply. So how do we fix that? Well, the easiest thing would be to simulate a real input line. So taking our ideal input supply and connecting it to our power supply through a resistor and inductor. So any sort of wires you will be using from your battery or whatever you're using to power your supply will have a certain resistance and a certain inductance. And if we simulate it this way, then we will see that we start to have noise on our input. So we can see our switching action also creating disturbance on our input. So how do you choose these values? I mean, I put 1 ohm and 1 microhenry, but should I put more? Should I put less? What would be some recommended values? Well, there's an answer to this, of course, and it comes in the form of the LISN, or Line Impedance Stabilization Network. Basically, this is a standard circuit used for emission testing. mostly conducted emission. Basically, it's a standard inductor, some capacitors. On one side you will put your battery or main supply in this case, on the other side your unit that you're testing, and then you also have a dedicated output that you should connect to spectrum analyzer or any such instrument. And based on what you're trying to simulate, you will have various values for the component in your LISN network. So I got such circuit modeled right here, in which I added my LISN network to my power supply. And if I simulate it this way, we can see that we have our input noise, and we can also take it from this dedicated output, which is centered around 0 volts. So if you're actually involved in certain compliance testing of various electronic units, you will need to model this input network as close as possible to the one that you will actually be using during testing. And now that you got your output noise taken from the output of your LISN network, you can also perform an FFT analysis on it. So simply click on the FFT command and you can see its spectral content. There's more information about how to properly do this in one of my older videos, so how to get the most out of this sort of FFT analysis. Now, about this LISN network, there's two things to mention. First of all, at the moment, I'm only using it on my plus supply, but in reality, you will also use it on your minus supply. So both of your input wires will be connected through this sort of network to your battery. Now, at the moment, if I look at my two outputs, they're showing you exactly the same thing, only one inverted to the other, since all the current going in through one is coming out through the other. But in reality, we're missing one more very important component, and that is the capacity between your circuit and the ground. So your circuit ground doesn't just connect through this LISN network to ground, it will also connect through an extra parasitic capacitor of various value. So let's say 1 picofarad for the sake of this simulation. And if we add this, our two waveforms, although looking quite similar still, will have very slight differences. And these differences will be observed if we look at what's going on through our capacitor. And we can see that, although very small, there is a certain noise going on through this also. So again, it's all about simulating your circuit as close as possible to your real conditions. The better you will model this parasitic capacitance, the closer your result will be to what you have in real life. And now that we have all our input noise properly modeled and properly measured, let's try and do something about it. So the first thing that we can do, of course, is adding an inductor capacitor filter, so making a pi filter on our input. This way we can see that although we have quite a lot of noise directly on our supply input, by using this filter, it will be mostly reduced. So you can see that this pink line is almost perfectly straight. Another thing that we can take into account that comes into play, especially when using very large units with very large ground capacitance, is adding common mode chokes. So we can add this sort of transformer in LTSpice with a transformer command, and this will also help us to filter out common mode noise. And that's about it for today. I will leave all these simulations in a link down below. So just a short recap. When you want to simulate circuits, and especially the noise your circuits make, it's very important to simulate only the components that you actually need, so no point in simulating all sorts of complicated ICs that don't really interfere with whatever noise you're generating. Reduce simulation time to as little as possible so you can make as many runs as possible in the shortest amount of time. Swap out all your ideal components with real components and model every single parasitic that these components have. Take into account as much as possible your layout parasitics, and then you can start to work on your input and output noise sources. But of course, the best way to work on this is to actually start working on the source of the noise. So don't start with filtering, start with the root causes. And depending on what you're trying to simulate, you can also add these LISN type filters to see not just the output noise, but also the input noise. And that's about it. So, hope you got some useful information out of this. Leave your thoughts in the comments. Thank you for watching. Make sure to subscribe to my channel to be up to date with all my latest videos. And hope to see you next time. Bye bye.